attain enlightenment means to have complete composure in our life.
The first time I met him, I came in there with my boots on, and I walked into the meditation hall, and somebody came out from the opposite door, and it was actually Suzuki Roshi. He walked up to the altar. I didn't look at him, he didn't look at me, because I've been watching samurai movies. So, and he didn't look at me, because he was a Zen master. And he went up to the altar, climbed up the platform, and he rearranged the flowers in this tall vase. And so when I saw him doing that, I said, this is square Zen. So I left. But in retrospect, because of his being a Zen master and doing something 100%, actually he was rearranging my mind. I think he was the first person I met that had a very gentle and kind, but at the same time, tremendous strength. I think of him like a pearl rolling across a table. No hindrances, no obstacles, it's very smooth. But that's what I saw. He used the word soft mind, so it was open to everything. There was just a wonderful vibration he exuded everywhere he went. In fact, when he would go down in the street, if he saw a bum, there weren't homeless people then. Mm-hmm. If he saw a bum in the street, and he would always wear his full outfit, his robes, he would stop and bow to the person. In spite of how soft and gentle he was, he could be like a terror in his own way. It was just by his presence, maybe he would say, "You can't leave." Or don't move. I was so petrified that he was going to find something unpleasing about me. So when I went in there, I was just petrified. One time he told me that, he said, maybe at nighttime you could have a glass of wine before you went to bed. Because I was so uptight, I was just like this. He knew what meditation, Zazen, was about. He had fathomed it. He would have us sit a very long time, very long. It was more of his example. His example of him becoming the Buddha. And showing us how, talk after talk, it's more of his action, what he did and how he placed things down, the way he walked, the way he stood, when he sat, when he fell asleep, everything he did. And of course his unconditional love for, you know, all of us, that we could tell him things and he wouldn't make a judgment on us. And very open, yeah. Maybe in some way he knew that he didn't have that much time. So within 10 years he really established something. And not just the buildings, but something in us. The year that he died, we were working on the transmission papers. And we would practice, it was February, January, February, we would practice doing the calligraphy together, the Buddha's names. And when we continued to work during the transmission, I realized how exhausted he was. And he would drop his brush. You know, literally, when he was holding his brush, he would drop it because he couldn't hold his brush. And I felt so unworthy to go back, so I never went back again. But that was my mistake. The true Zen student would just continue to go back. He wanted to live when he found out he had cancer. But what is this want for? It wasn't for him personally, it was for us. So the want is different. He didn't want to die because he knew that we were too young. We only had 10 years with him. And he asked the Buddha, he said, "Give me 10 more years." Not for himself, for us. See, that's the point. That's the big difference. And the Buddha said, no, you can't have 10 years. He knew how to live. He knew how to die. He was a true Zen master.
When you have this kind of confidence in yourself, in your being, we can practice true Zazen, which is beyond perfect or imperfect, good or bad. Beyond perfect or imperfect, good or bad.
One more time.